crisis. A little bit of change for today's agenda, like I also already mentioned. I'd just like to run you through. So we take a short break. We are not going to take a very long break. So about 10, 15 minutes. Rather, I request, so the tea is going to be served outside. You can actually get your tea quickly and finish it. So we regroup at about 11:15. From 11:15 to about, I think to about 1, we'd like to go into the mentoring sessions. We'll take you through what the process will be. And after that, we'll break for lunch. And post-lunch, we will have the mock pit sessions. And then we'll continue the day as is. So I hope that's fine with everyone. And so we can take a break right now. And around 11:10, 11:15, I mean, 5 minutes to 11 right now. So 11:10, we can come back. It'll be great. Thank you. Also, how to make the right pitch. I hope you have some important lessons to take from there as well. Thank you.
Okay, so after yesterday, what are the two or three things that you learned about investors after yesterday's sessions? Two or three things that come on the top of your mind.
Yeah, the first thing I think was that what they say is not sacrosanct. You know, you don't have to take them in front. That is
okay. What are they looking for?
To make money. Mm. And obviously they can't, you know, unless they invest, they can't make money.
Mm.
They're also looking for the right kind of partners.
Mm.
So it's a two-way street. It's not that, you know, we have to be...
How do they make money?
Investing in
prices. Yeah, yeah, investing, obviously. But after investing, how will they make money?
Then exit. Whenever they exit. But depending on what kind of investment they have, they're not allowed to invest in debt.
So, assume we are looking at equity investment here. The primary way they'll make money is, most cases, exit. In most of your businesses, you will not have enough cash to pay out as dividends or anything. So, I think as promoters, one of the key disconnects we see is between the promoter and the investor is when the promoter is starting a business, he's very passionate about it and he wants to stay in it for the long run, and there is an investor, he's looking out for an investor, and the investor comes in and he is looking, even the moment he's putting his money, he's thinking about when he can get out of the business. So that disconnect is sort of there, right? But as promoters, you have to live with that disconnect and you have to understand what the investor is looking for the moment you pitch to him the first time around, right? Because if you go with them with your own passion and extreme passion and say, this is a great business and we can do so many things with this business, you may not find many buyers, because ultimately you'll have to understand what the investor wants from investing in your business and how we'll make happen. Because ultimately they are looking to make, most investors are looking to make money. There are some who are looking at social impact, which is critical, right? So this pitching, and usually what happens is that in the first two or three conversations, the investor has to a certain extent made up his mind about the business, right? Whether they want to go forward with that conversation with you or not. And those two or three conversations might sometimes be very critical in most cases. And I just want to start with this little piece here to give you an idea of sometimes how the way you position the business sometimes changes the entire thing. I mean, you have to get the investor excited about your business. If you just focus on the small nitty-gritties, even the big picture, the large picture, right? So sometimes that makes a huge difference in getting the investor interested in the first place, right? So the idea is, for this session, like this 2 hours, like she mentioned, I will just give you a brief idea of what things you should, maybe two or three points that you need to focus on while making your pitch presentations, and then we can start working on that, those things. I think these are the three critical things that you need to focus on in your pitch. I mean, to put it very simply, three things. In the first three conversations, four conversations, you have to capture his attention or her attention. And how do you do that? First thing is, why should you put money in your business? What is so great about your business? Right? And when you say that business is great, most people think in terms of market opportunity. Right? You will say that, for example, if somebody is doing solar lamps, they would say there is a massive section of the population which does not have access to electricity. But the thing that most people forget is that investors are interested in converting that market opportunity to revenue potential. Right? For example, 3-4 years back, I was looking at a solar lighting company. Right. The whole this, they gave this whole pitch about the entire villages being not being electrified, so much demand, etc., etc. Very nice. But in, at the end of it, in their whole presentation, there was no clue as to how that opportunity is to be tapped in. Right? And the critical piece where, well, there was the distribution piece, which they had not actually tackled there. So it's very important that when you talk about, we all know the market opportunity in each of your segments. If you are in agriculture, there is a massive opportunity, right? If you are in solar lighting, there is a massive opportunity. If you are in healthcare, there is again a massive opportunity. But the critical part is converting that opportunity into revenue potential. I think in your audio presentations, I think that should be very, very critical. That focus should be there. And the second thing is, if your business is completely in a new segment, for example, there is a company which has come up with eye testing equipment, right? Portable eye testing equipment. There is a company called Forest Healthcare. I don't know if you have heard of it, right? It captured a lot of interest because as it is, eye testing equipment was very expensive. This could be actually carried to a village. A very sort of untrained person could use that to test it, test people's eyes, right? So that created a completely new segment there. In terms of market. So if there is something like, you are doing something like that, it will make a huge difference to the way the investor perceives. There are drawbacks to it also, because sometimes when you are creating, operating in a new segment, it sometimes leads to a situation where you have to create a market for it. Right?
Yeah, there are many drawbacks to the
investor. Yeah. So sometimes you have to create a new market, which sort of creates difficulties for yourself. So you have to understand what the investor is looking for in your own business, whether there are sufficient incentives in that business, in a completely new segment, to sort of offset the drawbacks, right? The second question is, once you have proven to the investor, right, there is this massive opportunity, I can capture it, it is actually can be realized. The second question is, why you? As a promoter, as a team, as an organization, why you? For example, I think you have experience in, not you, I think one of the participants here in the, I think solar lighting or something I saw, that they have experience in sustainable energy, they have done some course in sustainable energy or something like that. So the question is, it makes a lot of importance to highlight your previous experience, what you bring to the table, that's very, very critical as a promoter. Because like I said, in early stage businesses, the investors are very, very focused on it. Because you are the person who is going to scale this business up. Whatever the opportunity, you are the person and you and your team. So, is it some? Do you have previous entrepreneurial experience? Do you have previous academic experience? Do you understand the sector? Do you have networks in the sector? It's very critical to prove that you know people in this sector. Right? Because that is crucial. And in some cases, if you just prove that you already thought about the scaling of part. Right? What does scaling up mean? I mean in terms of processes, right? For example, I remember in 2007 or 8, there is this company called Equitas Microfinance in Chennai. At that time, nobody had even thought of the kind of processes that he had put in place. To scale up, all the processes, the way he had thought about the business was so impressive that there was a line of investors waiting to invest in it. He had already thought about what he will do when he is a 100 crore business. What kind of process required to reach that? Right? So, have you thought about that? That sort of shows your ability to think for the long term and that you have a long term vision for the business. It's very important to convey that in your pitch. Because ultimately, like I said, I started out with a simple statement. What is the investor looking for? Obviously, returns. How does he realize the returns? Through exit. And how does he exit the business? He scales. So the focus, starting with exit, the focus is on scaling your business. I am assuming a normal investor here. There are investors who can be very patient and say, no, for us impact is very important. We will stay with you for the long term, etc., etc. But I'm talking about a normal run-of-the-mill investor. And once you have done that, the critical question is sort of saying that what is in it for you finally? Okay. Like you have proven the market opportunity, you are saying I am the best person to capture that market opportunity, I thought of all the possibilities. Now you have to prove to him that if your business scales and everything happens, he is going to get a return. And in case of social impact investors, there is an additional thing of social impact. You have to clearly prove to them that there is an impact. Most investors will be, most of the investors that you people will be talking to will be very much interested in that angle, right? So you have to prove to them in your presentations. I think just by saying that, okay, there will be impact livelihoods, that is a very general statement. If you are able to more quantify it or something like that, like yesterday we explained, not put an Excel sheet there, but maybe some parameters which say that maybe you are tracking them and there is a focus on that. That will make a huge difference. So be prepared for that kind of questions when you come. Because some investors say that we have certain focus in certain segments, say the urban segment, or maybe these this particular segment of the population who are earning less than say certain dollars per day or something like that. So you have to be very, very clear on whether that impact is happening in your business. And finally, when you are pitching to the investor, it's also important, like we discussed yesterday, it's very important to understand what is he looking for, right, before you go and talk to him. I think a random kind of mass mailing system usually doesn't help. It helps for you to do some research on what he wants and then go and pitch to the investor, using all these three things that we talked about. And that sort of helps you to make a very effective pitch to the investor. And sometimes what happens is businesses in the same sector, right, sometimes are pitched differently. So suppose you are operating in a low income state, then your pitch could be completely different compared to say you are operating in a southern state, for example. If you have a team which is very strong, you could be highlighting that. If you have come up with some new business model in the same sector which sort of helps you make it more capital efficient, that you could be highlighting that. So all these things come together, and I think it's very critical that the important point that you have to remember is to think from the investor's point of view. Ultimately, a promoter has to just step out and stand in the, and that's sometimes very difficult for an entrepreneur, right? Because you have started a business, you are very passionate about it, and then comes a person who says, I'll put money, I want exit in 5 years, 6 years, whatever. Standing in his shoes is very, very critical as a promoter. And that is some which sometimes people appoint investment bankers to do that job for them. But as promoters, you have to start thinking about that, because that's not important only for your pitch. It's also important for your coexistence with the investor. Okay? So I'll sort of leave you with this. Then I think we'll break into groups and we can do this.
Thank you, Satish. So what we will do now is that we'll break into groups of, we'll break into three groups, sector wise. So what I will do is, we have three mentors here, Reena Mittal and Manvi are investors from Sankhya Partners. They will be handling one group, and the enterprises we've assigned are GB Meditech, Kids and Ram Taran. So we'll be sitting with them. So that's one group. Satish will take care of agriculture sector, so Bhushan Agro, Eco Tusser and Kotalya. And Rajesh over there. And Rajesh is from Siddhi Ventures. He is going to take Grameen and Claro as part of the team. So what we will do is we break into three groups. You can use this room. The enterprises can sit with their mentors individually. You can take one by one. We'll go, each enterprise can go one by one, so we can just figure out which enterprise wants to go first. what you need to do is showcase your current existing template that we have shared with you, so some feedback will go back into your presentations with your mentor. You can use this room, you can go down to the activity area, you feel free to use any of the space that you need. We will, the time we have kind of allotted for this is till 1 p.m. So you can spend as much time with your mentors, get an understanding of what your current pitch is, what all is needed, rework, please go back. So that's the time they have been kind enough to spare for you all, and we take it from there.
If you'd like, you could even move down to the atrium and sit on the couches there. You can be in the auditorium, sorry.
Like, I was discussing with her about the modern city and I don't think it. My background is, I'm from Tippy into small industry development. So we understand industry, but that untapped business potential has to be seen. And what makes you catch the market? You are the only person. That's one situation. But there are many players and you are one of the best. If that is the situation, you have to show all your strength. Be changing the business model, the process, distribution, with service, and that is, that will be very important. And that would be seen in people. You have to go first, or?
Okay, mine was just on the
soap. Yeah. A little brief background about ourselves.
Yeah.
So we started operations in June 2011, where we seized this opportunity for other kinds of biomass to cook their daily meals. And the rest 20%, 80% is the penetration of LPG. Out of 18%, 10% have cylinders, but they don't have regular supply of gas. So the market opportunity in terms of market, just the market size is around 160 million households in India. And close to 1 billion households around the globe, which includes Africa, Bangladesh, and other countries alike. So we cover around 500,000 in India, and it's the danger to children and infants and So that was the entire idea. So we did a lot of market survey, 9 months, we took different prototypes, the models. So this is the ninth prototype that we developed. So we traveled around 1 lakh kilometers. So across the 100,000 kilometers across the world, that's the final product. So the key differentiator between this product and what is locally available is our
farming experience and the business and operational experience. And I believe the opportunity, is known to everyone. Our productivity in India for most of the class, almost 1/4 the productivity So there is tremendous opportunity. Suicide planning is non-degenerative productivity. Has been trained or in various workshops by the government courses. But just training them, they need to see. That's why they're giving more preparation and having demo clubs. So they are able to see the difference. Yeah? Good number of them, they just start following. So in short, that is the model. So going forward, but initially, if you can see, you require a little bit more size. Of course, the infrastructure is not there. Basic infrastructure is not there. So you need to purchase the rest of it. So that is the model. I have a model.
Start with what you are making now and then what you think you can make. Based on your current market.
It means to other avenues.
I think it, in this sense, it sort of means really how can you reach your client base or what is your client base? Right?
Yeah, oh, absolutely. Distribution, I mean, do you have health centers or do you have outreach clinics or, basically
how
deep can you go? So,
Also, maybe over here, it's also a question of, can you identify new patients? I think that's another interesting thing.
In which?
No, in impact. How many people's lives and how? How will you affect their lives? To cure them, will you just have to identify them?
I can get the same outcome. That's a better
question. Diabetes is not curable in that sense, so it's more about
we can conduct awareness to.
Yes, you can conduct awareness, exactly. For preventive care.
Yes.
Given up for the better. So that's one. You utilize part of medium, in both cases 35.
And then the next thing is actually competition.
Next point, I'm talking about a very short situation.
So, my suggestion would be that this might be something we have as we are putting the details of being very specific about all the features in time. That kind of thing is more
great. Now, do you need to say,
you are not trying to talk about how to do it, but there is a person trying to talk about how to do it without any experience. That's just how it is. And not even decreasing the market or your size or will not decrease, will not shrink as quickly as the market.
Okay, fine.
So, that's the part. All these banks are also the team mandate and commercialization is to set up a distribution. So, another issue is to where we have distributors.
I
Okay, but how are you going to attract the market share? What do you want to say? I mean, that yes, you have
collaboration between DFID, SIDBI, and SIDBI Venture. DFID and SIDBI would be the contributor for the fund, and SIDBI Venture will be the manager. SIDBI Venture operates traditionally from Bombay, but this particular fund is operating from Lucknow, and I am the projected for the Samriddhi Fund. We will be there at Patna when the final session takes place. And Samriddhi Fund has got focus, one is geographical focus. It is focusing on the 8 states, low income state. Typically this UP, Bihar, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, Rajasthan, Odisha, West Bengal. These are the 8, 7, 8 states which is the targeting. And a venture which is obviously something which is commercially viable, sustainable, which has got potential, which also has social impact. High on ESG, economic, social and governance aspect, which directly affects at least masses, I won't say all the bottom of the pyramid, but large population, and large population typically will not be at the top of the pyramid, especially when you are talking about the poorer state. Any venture, so most of the ventures we are looking into is what typically we call social ventures, be it water supply, sanitation, health, off-grid, e-governance, something, weather forecasting, agricultural mart sort of thing, a service, you have got mall for general purposes, agricultural mall sort of thing, we are looking into. So proposals are diverse. The crux of the consideration is it should be have businesses and focus in these 8 states. It should have a venture which has got a potential, commercially viable, not based on the grants and things like that. Maybe in short run it's loss making, but finally it sees a commercial viability, and which affects, positively affects large people. Maybe employment generation, maybe solving their day-to-day life problem with like solar power, off-grid power supplies, sanitation, rural water supply. We are looking at least 3-4 companies which are providing water to consume people, safe drinking water for a price. You don't pay a price, even the rich don't pay a price at water supply at home. Normally tap water you get it from water supply, then village you take water from wells, pumps, whatever it is. But water per se you don't buy. I also don't buy, and most of the people don't buy. But we are looking at a business model where water is being bought by the people on a day-to-day, everyday basis, daily basis, and you pay for it because it helps you in so many other ways to save your cost and money and things, and it's being seen as a financially viable business model. So what I want to say is any business which affects population, large group of people, as a consumer, as a worker, as an employee, or as a citizen of the state, have a positive impact, and once integrate these states will be the focus and target of the community. And that's what we will be looking at. Any more query on this? Which I can take it at this point of
ticket size of the investment, any
ticket size, we have not very rigid on the ticket size, but from the convenience and administrative point of view, managing the fund size, fund investment, typically 5 crore would be something we will be looking at, but it's not as it is now.
What stage, early stage or
any?
Are there any product development funds as well?
Pardon?
Product development funds from.
Product development fund,
yes.
A separate fund for other purposes.
Yes.
As a grant, which should come as a grant?
Probably.
No grant fund at this point.
Your expectation of return?
Expectation of return is, I will say, moderate. It's not a private equity fund which looks for 30, 35, 40% return, but obviously it should give more than the normal banking rate. That is, I will say. And we are not capping it up for investment.
Is agriculture a focus area?
Pure agriculture may not be, is not rather, because being fund being managed by SIDBI, SIDBI has a mandate from Government of India, is set up under the Act of Parliament, and its mandate is MSME. So agri processing is fine, but crop production may not be. The processing unit is fine, which gets licensed for registration with DIC and you get MSME. So you can't be outside in the large scale. As long as you are in MSME, you are eligible. Any other query? Okay, thank you.
So now we'll break into groups like Meenakshi had said earlier for the mock pitch. Each enterprise will get 10 minutes to make your presentation, and followed by 10 minutes for question answers from your peers and from the mentor in the group. The groups are GV Meditech, Grameen Infra and Claro in one group that will be moderated by Mr. Rajesh from SIDBI, and Kids, EcoTussar and Bhushan Agro in group 2 that will be moderated by Ms. Gina and Manvi from Sankhya. So EcoTussar, Kids and Bhushan Agro will remain in this group, and the other group will come
you can follow me and guide you down to the room on floor 1. And you can give me your presentations once we're in the room. Over here, you can give the presentations to Priyanka and we'll put it up.
We are into the hand-woven textiles field, which is basically a rural business. We have been, we sell hand-woven off-the-loom, ready-to-wear items like saris, dupattas, stoles, scarves. And we also do home furnishing items out of fabric that we weave, like cushion covers. Though we are located, the marketing and head office is located in Delhi. We, our production is all in rural areas like Bhagalpur, Fulya in West Bengal, and we source yarn from all over the catchment area of this weaving clusters like Jharkhand, the parts of Bihar, also from Assam. We started off as a livelihood project, business extension of Pradhan, and this was spun off as a separate company in the year 2007. We have just completed 5 years. In fact, we started on 1st October 2007. We have completed 5 years. We have been sustainable right from the day, the first day. And what's unique about us is that we leverage manual processes which are otherwise obsolete, hand weaving, hand block printing, etc. We leverage the strength of small lots that a hand weaver or a block printer can do, and use design resources very extensively to make a product which is really attractive for the contemporary market. Right now, we are looking for an investment of around 5 crores so that we can actually capture more value through a stitching and printing unit which we will seed in somewhere near Bhagalpur. We have, over a period of time, we started off an equity of 20 lakhs when we were formed. Over a period of 5 years, we have added reserves and brought it up to 142 lakhs. And we have also raised debt financing from Exim Bank and other mainstream banks to the tune of 127 lakhs. So far, we haven't had any prizes because we have never been into any award functions. I have 22 years of experience, work experience, out of which the last 12 years have been in this sector. Prior to that, I was an entrepreneur. I used to manufacture mobile toilet vans, which is very different from what I do now. Most of our weaving happens in Bihar and West Bengal, though we source yarn from Bihar, Assam, Jharkhand also. And if you are to look at the value captured by the producers in the rural areas, it's almost 45% of our top line. With this investment, we are going to reach out to 8,672-71 households, comprising primarily of yarn makers, tribal sericulturers, weavers, and other people in the weaving chain. Cumulatively, if we are going to hit our targets, we would be creating wage opportunity to the tune of 17.5 crores a year for this 8,671 families. The apparel market in India itself is huge, but then obviously it's not just silk, it's all together. It's closer to 2,90,000 crores. The silk industry is obviously a subset of it, but it's a high premium subset. And what we have, there's no official figure available, but what we estimate is our target segment is a woman 30 plus working women from a household earning at least 4 lakh rupees a year. That estimate is approximately 4.5 such households are there in class 1 and urban cities. The market is growing at a fairly compounded annual growth rate of 9%, and this is more or less how it will be over the next 7 to 10 years. The sari market overall is approximately 28,870 altogether, both synthetic, cotton, and silk. Our estimates are the silk sari market should be at least 8 to 10 crores out of that, 8,000 to 10,000 crores out of that. We also, with this investment, we also intend to get into kurtis, you know, printing and stitching unit will use our fabric to manufacture kurtis. This is a growing market. See, what has happened is, over a period of time in India, from need-based clothing, people have now started doing occasion-based clothing. This is an, you know, result of more affluence, more women working out, working, and it is envisaged that it will become more and more design and detail-oriented market. This actually serves very well the kind of segment we are in, because with handloom and handmade techniques, we can create a lot of variety, a lot of interesting product with a solid story, because this has a social relevance, and the product is also totally green, in the sense that in the entire value chain, excepting for dyeing, there is absolutely no use of any energy or any chemicals. In dyeing, we as a company, from day one, we have been using azo-free dyes, and going forward, we intend to invest in our own dyeing facility with effluent treatment plants, etc. We have two segments, primary segment. Our turnover is equally divided between the two. One is the Indian women wear segment, which is, like I had already told you, that it's approximately 4.5 crore strong, and you know, something like 8,000 to 10,000 crores altogether. We also do a lot of cushion, silk cushion covers for the overseas market, particularly to the, you know, European and American market. This is anyway, what we produce is anyway the premium segment of the market. Even in cushion covers, our export prices are $10 a piece, and it retails for anything between $35 to $55. As far as current market share is concerned, when you are looking at an industry which is 290 crore, 1,000 crores, and I have turnover of 5 crores, it's a very negligible market share, but there's enough ample scope for growth. Even, you know, trying to find out who are the top 3 players is very difficult, because it's a very fragmented kind of an industry. What our primary value proposition is, that we are a design-led company. We are leveraging a lot of design resources to create products which are very contemporary and very fashionable. And we do a very rapid turnaround, because our production systems are geared for that. Handloom, you could do small lots, you could do, you know, every lot could be different. The basic premise on which any fashion industry is built is people want variety. Retailers want as much variety as possible, and they don't repeat the variety. So, look at your own psychology. You would go to a shop, you might have actually liked something that you bought last time, but you are not going to buy the same thing again. If you see it there, you would come back and say, there's nothing new there. So, that basic consumer need for variety is possible to address through a production model of handloom and, you know, handmade. Ours is also a green product, which is a story which is becoming more and more compelling even for Indian consumers, and in times to come it will become more, you know, a sellable story. Plus, we are also socially relevant, in the sense that whatever you buy, a significant portion of it goes to poor producers in areas where they need work and they need the wage opportunity. As far as customer feedback is concerned, we, I'll just give you an indication of that. our customer feedback is that we have been increasing our customer base from year to year. We sell to the trade. So, you know, that is the kind of indication. And like at the last line, I'm, you know, our product, somebody had taken it to a trade show in Paris. One of the buyer said, is this by any chance from Basavai Pradhan? So, you know, it's, we have been able to create a very distinctive and different look. We have, you know, our profit after tax has been consistently 10%, 9 to 10% over the years. And we have very low break even because we are, anyway, most of it is outsourced. The whole production chain is, you know, it's all job work. Right now we are selling to 138 sari shops and we have over 300 buyers both in boutique and other sites. In the overseas we are selling to two large accounts, one of them is Port Vidal Group. It's a large market. If you can position ourselves well, we can scale up to a large extent. But then it comes with a caveat. The kind of production model that we want to work with, our bottom line is actually creating a large number of livelihoods sustainably. And that model cannot go to like 1000 crore or 2000 crore. We would be very happy if we, over 4 or 5 years, we can scale up that production model to something like 200 crores or so. Or, you know, something like that. Even that would be a big challenge because managing so many numbers across so many villages in, you know, this thing. But it has got a leverage and it is required that that kind of opportunity should be provided, you know, businesses should have, you know, all of the kind of businesses have to be there. Most of the employment that would create is for artisans and really poor women. And to just give you an, these are people who are in our production chain. The current team is, I am the CEO, and we have Deep Joshi, who is the founder of Pradhan, which was which incubated this business, is on the board, and two more Pradhanites who are active Pradhanites right now. This is the kind of growth we have had in the last 3 years, and this is what we are looking at if we are able to invest. Even otherwise, organically, we look at something like in 4 years' time, 18 crore or top line, even if without the infusion of equity or not. Thank you.
How are you going to use the money? It's really to expand the production line. You know, you're not
going
to start selling to retail outlets
on your own, right? Yeah. At the moment, the pitch that I have made is for consolidating the production back end. We have plans that 4 years down the line, we will start a limited number of retail shops. The whole idea is that we would use those retail shops to first showcase our designs and then, you know, after a limited period, we will just put it in the infosecret. We have that advantage because we are already supplying to stores across the country. Fortunately, in sarees, you don't do a mass marketing, so a woman in Cochin may not know that it is available in a store in Delhi. So, you know, to that extent, we will be able to, once we sell it, we will be able to capture more value from retail, but without the downside of getting stuck with unsold stock. So, it also gives us a direct access to consumer and the preferences, etc., which will aid our design and the understanding of the business more. But that then obviously will need more than the kind of fund that we are looking at.
That's what I was asking. And are you open to co-investment? So the whole 5 crore is not from one person or you're open
to it? Not very honest. We are totally new, we have no clue. The whole idea was to find out how it works.
That's why I'm bringing this up, because that's one question that you potentially get.
Yeah. I don't know, this is a small sum of money. As long as we have investors who are okay with our double bottom line, on one hand, we need to be commercially sustainable and make reasonably good sum of money, but it's more important for us to create a large number of livelihood opportunity. So, if you get an investor who has similar kind of, you know, goals, I think. But then, you know, the whole thing can only work if you are able to raise at least 5 crore. Because the unit itself will cost around 1.5 crore.
how will you deal with the whole issue, the question of exit, which is, I guess, what came up earlier in the day? So that's what most investors will ask, unfortunately, but that is what they'll ask.
How that's something we, at this point of time, I can't visualize whether we'll go public or, you know, whether we can buy them back or I don't know how it works and what kind of expectation they have. We would be most happy if we can get patient long-term debt.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, that was going to be my next question.
But apparently the, you know, venture capital industry can't give you debt.
Well, but other people can give you that.
Money. Yeah, I would be most happy.
Just to take debt with a revenue share sort of way of repayment. You don't have to charge exorbitant rates of interest, but you basically say that the interest rate is dependent on your revenue growth, let's say.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that sounds good.
Some debt is there, but that's something you need to talk about. That's definitely something that I think is worth considering.
Because most of our investments are in working capital.
Right. Exactly.
So the, you know, the quantum machinery is capex is very small.
Right.
You know.
Yeah.
And that we can even, you know, internal accruals we can do that, expecting to do, but then the working capital need is there, and since we don't have collateral, banks are, most of the bank loans that you see are unsecured bank loans, EMI based. So, you know, we haven't been able to access mainstream bank loans yet.
Except the interest rates are very high, I think.
18%. But at the same time, we have got a loan from Exim Bank, which is 6% plus 5% points. So it works out. And we have been, when we were floated, our one of the, it's a joint venture between me and the cooperative. All the investments made by Pradhan and the cooperative over a period of time was monetized under GAAP. Part of it was equity and part of it was debt. We have been paying 15% year on year on that debt. And, you know.
You know, anecdotally, there's a lot of tussar silk that's woven in Bhagalpur and these areas. So, but coming back to the first page of your presentation, you know, the uniqueness. The uniqueness that you talked about, small lot sizes, would be unique to all producers.
Yeah, not, you're right and wrong. Right in the sense, everybody is small producer, including us.
And there are.
You're wrong meaning you can boss my person.
Small meaning?
Wrong in the sense that you can boss my cluster. You can't boss anybody else's cluster. You know, we have done those kind of improvement in the product. We, a trader in Bhagalpur will not have the kind of designs that we have. He will not turn around the kind of designs that we turn around. Like I said, the person in Paris who had bought our product 2-3 years back saw it and said, is this from cluster or product? We have a very distinctive look. You see Bartha Dutt wearing it all the time. You see Mr. Chaudhary wearing it. So, you know, we supply to Fab India from day one. We are one of our, right now not the key customer, but consistently we have been supplying to them. It's just Fab India kind of look. Elegant, you can wear it to office, but.
Fab India Tassar is not
washable. Fab India Tassar is, we just supply soles to them.
Okay.
Sanitary can supply.
Definitely
not supply stores to them.
Why did you hesitate from putting a number to how much the market is currently willing to pay? I mean, you know, you could have talked about the price point for your products. In your presentation, you didn't mention a number.
Number in the sense?
As in the price point, you know, for your products.
We actually have different products. So in sarees, we wholesale for 2800 rupees, that's the basic range, and it goes up to 4500 rupees. Now the same thing in retail sales for 5800 rupees. You know, and you know, it differs from design to design, and we have, you know, like certain points, like 2800 is first point, and then 3500 is next, then 4000, 4200, and 4500.
Okay, one last question I had is that I couldn't make out whether it was 8671 households or persons, because the slide said persons, but you referred to it as households. And whether that is post the proposed investment or whether you're currently employing that?
Currently, ma'am, we are impacting 1388 lives, which we, the way we calculated is people who are working with us full time, like we are working with almost 140 viewers at any point, given point of time. We are working with almost 55 people who do the freelancing. There are 18, there are 3 dyers who do 90% of the capacity is being tied up by us. We have a unit in Noida where we are employing around 35 people to do the stitching.
So it's 1381.
1388 is the number of people with this turnover we are impacting. Part of them are part-timers.
Okay.
You know, people who make the passes. But what if you were to see exactly, if you were to divide the total wages that we have incurred by 36,000 rupees, that is the kind of benchmark that you have, 3,000 rupees in a place like Bhagalpur is what a weaver or a finisher would get. It's almost 400 livelihoods. But a lot of them are actually part-time as well.
Just, I may not understand the context, but as I understand this, what we're supposed to be doing is helping someone to make their presentation, right? How do you make a presentation? One of the most important things in making presentations, people have to love it. So you have to say, what is it about what I'm doing that somebody's going to love? It's going to be grabbed, they're going to grab it. In this case, it seems to me the most important thing you have is beautiful fabric. So if I was going to make a presentation about you, I would start with, this is what we make, and it's beautiful. Second thing I would say is, and I sell it in all kinds of places. I don't know if you said 138 places, and I sell it in Paris. The people in Paris love this, and here's why. It's washable, it's blah, 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 it's green. And then I would say, in addition to that, it's made by very poor people, like this lady. You want to show a person that makes this, okay? But the most important thing is somebody's got to love what you make. And you should start with that. You can show a picture of something, and then if, I don't know all the people that you're referring to, but if this is some famous people wear your stuff, you should show that right away. Here's a Shwari Rai wearing mine. Thing, you know, that's what you want to show. Or here's Manmohan Singh wearing my, you know, silk thing. But it's those things that work. All this stuff in this form is not what sells the transaction. Yeah. That happens afterwards, the details, what your revenues are, and all these things. But in the beginning, you have to get somebody to love what it is that you do. And you, in particular, have very good service. So if you were asking me, I have 10 minutes for these people, what do I want to cover? First, these two women should say, oh yeah, I know that stuff, that's great, I've seen that, and oh, it's washable? Whoa, that's great. That's what you have to do to get them to emote about what you're doing. And then, if your revenue is 3/4, that's a detail. You see what I mean? That's the most important thing. What is it about me that people are going to love that's unusual? Okay. Pictures of fabrics and people wearing them.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Okay. 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 Okay.
CEO of Bhushan Agro, and you know, there are middlemen, you know, powerful people who have their own selfish interests to propagate, you know, various things. So somehow or the other, the farmer is not benefiting, and the yield is not improving. I mean, you would know the only yield, the significant improvement in yield, for example, in wheat, happened in 1960s. I mean, since then there has hardly been any improvement in yield. So there is something wrong, and. So our company tries to, you know, bridge the gap between scientific knowledge and also demonstrate to the farmers by implementing it. Farmers are being shown, you know, many things that can be done, but nobody is actually demonstrating them in the farm. Look, I will take 5 acres, do it right in front of you in your village and demonstrate that this 5 acres will produce much more economically than your 5 acres. So this is a challenge that nobody is able to take. So, we believe that by leasing lands, So we lease lands from farmers, both large and small farmers, and then do farming. So in the process, we demonstrate it to them. So that is how, you know, and how do we increase their income? We pay them, you know, lease rentals, and when we reach, you know, productivity benchmarks, we will share incremental income with them. So that is how we will help them earn more than what they are able to earn on their own. That is how we increase the income of farmers. So the scientific methods, it might sound very simple, but the difference between scientific farming practices and the current farming practices in India is just huge. I mean, the proper scientific method, you know, will begin with the soil test. There is, you know, soil fertility. Soil fertility depends upon, you know, 14 to 15 elements. They have to be supplied to the soil in a balanced way. I mean, they just can't be, you know, dumped in the soil. They have to be supplied in a balanced way. Then, you know, there are various other, you know, methods like, you know, chiseling and a lot of other, you know, details regarding farming practices that have to be followed. And that too in a very disciplined manner. And they require, good number of them require modern machines as well. So a small farmer having, you know, 2 acre or 3 acre kind of land will just not be able to do all these things on his own, because such machines are also not available on hand. So our model, by aggregating land, it builds economies of scale, and that is how, by using, you know, scientific methods, we will increase the productivity. And we believe that, you know, we can improve, you know, farm productivity three times over a period of 3 years. So leasing is one model. We can also work on cost and revenue sharing model with farmers, and we can also, you know, provide consultancy to the farmers. So I will skip this slide for the time being. So these are the results that we have achieved so far. On an average, for the soybean or for wheat crop, we have got improvements of 30 to 35%, and even more in some of the select plots. And this is for our village, our plot, right? Because the current area is in a hilly region, it has wild animals, so we can't compare our productivity with, say, for example, productivity in some other region in Madhya Pradesh. But in that village itself, we have been able to demonstrate productivity. I mean, this year, I can say this year, we have already harvested, you know, 50% of our soybean. We are running 1 month ahead of schedule from last year. I mean, we are in a position today to sow the next crop, but we cannot do it. Why? Because the other farmers are, you know, still behind us, and we don't want to be the exceptions, you know, to begin with, because our sprouts will come out and then the wild animals will devour, you know, our sprouts. So these are the challenges, but the point is that we are 1 month ahead of schedule already. This 1 month actually is, if the wheat, for example, gets another additional month, you know, to ripen, the yield will be better, the grain will be better, the quality will be better. So these are, I mean, so we are already, you know, demonstrating these improvements to the farmers. And farmers have slowly and surely started to accept that, you know, there is some value in what we are doing. So from here I will move on to our management team. I am from a non-farming background. So I read an article about the fertility productivity improvements achieved by our CTO, Mr. Madhavan. So he is a farmer with 20 plus years of experience. I attended his workshop and, you know, got inspired and then decided to join full time to this. So he's our CTO, he stays in Chennai, but he's always available to, he advises us regarding crop management and farming practices using, you know, the e-farming model. We regularly send photographs of the crops, and that's how he advises us. And he visits, you know, our farms also regularly. So then there is Santosh Shukla, he brings that local connect, you know. So the local comforts to begin with, you know, in that village and in that cluster. And we have Amit Mittal, so he is based in, you know, Muzaffarnagar, UP. Now Muzaffarnagar, UP is, you know, advanced in farming comparison, you know, in comparison to Madhya Pradesh. So, so there is advanced know-how that he also brings to the table. So basically, if you see, somebody from Chennai is there, somebody from UP is there. So we have a know-how of various crops, different agronomical conditions. And going forward, when we expand in Madhya Pradesh, we will bring that know-how will be very valuable. And we also have Tanit Mapane, who has been our first investor, and he's also an advisor and a friend as well. So the team has 50 plus years of cumulative farming experience and experience in other businesses and
processes. So this is a graph that demonstrates the increase in revenue that we can make. So from 2 crore revenue of say 25,000 per annum per acre, we can move to from 2 to 3 crops and have a revenue of 1,000 acre. This is just for illustration purposes. But I mean, I can share the details later on how we can achieve these numbers. So this is the slide about our financial projections. This is our third year of operations. We would do approximately 20 lakhs in revenue. In 3 years with funding, we can reach 1,000 acres and 6.5 crores in revenue. And after that, the real growth will happen after that. And then we can reach a revenue of 200 plus crores. But the point is that this 3 year, that is year 1 to year 3, is very important. We will deliberately go slow. This phase requires a little bit more of capex. We need to have machines, we need to demonstrate, demo plots are required, and that farmers around our region, around our comfort zone, they have to see the difference, because they will become our spokesperson in future. So we have to train people, farm supervisor kind of people who can manage 100 acres, okay, and win the farmers in our region. So 1,000 acres in 3 years, it is not a very, it's a fairly conservative, rate of growth, but that is achievable. Now, once we achieve that, then the growth in the next 4 or 5 years will be very capex like, we will appoint one lead farmer per cluster. One cluster is of 500 acres. So that lead farmer would be responsible for developing that region. And by the time we will have, our business model, our productivity improvements will be proven, and that farmer will get, the requisite loans from the banks if required. So from year 4, 5, 6 onwards, the model becomes capex light, and it will be dependent more on the skills and quality of people. So this is the kind of investment that we are seeking at the moment, approximately $70,000 for the next 3 to 4 years. And we will use the capital for purchase of modern tools and tractors. We will have a demo plot, we will fence it, develop a modern training center where we can train farmers, do workshops, and other uses of capital are also mentioned on the side. To summarize, this is all I can say is that the opportunity is huge, because this is the most difficult chunk. I mean, people can build warehouses, people can build cold storages, people can develop hybrid seeds, but it's very difficult to get it implemented on the ground. So we will help the farmer, we will take the burden on our shoulders to begin with, right? And in the process, in 1, 2, or 3 years, we will train them so that they can take higher responsibilities. And we believe that once the yield is improved, that is the yield per acre improves, only then the farmer would benefit. Otherwise, having a cold storage or a warehouse will actually not impact the farmer's income. And as I mentioned earlier, in our model, we will share the revenue. For example, if the farmer is earning 5 rupees per acre, and with our effort, the revenue increases to 10. So the incremental, profit is 5 rupees. So that we will share in the ratio of 40 to 60%. So in our model, we will share, more with the farmer. That is how, more and more people will come and join us. Thank you.
So the money you are looking for now, I think one thing I would add is very looking at investor presentation, sort of say very clearly what you are going to use the money for. You mentioned it,
right. But
just to sort of, so if you are looking at $70,000, that's about 35 lakhs.
Right?
So what that's going to be used primarily for?
Purchase modern machines, develop it. I've given the percentages.
I didn't see that part. That's fine. You've given the percentage.
Right. So, and I mentioned the key milestones. That is basic.
Yeah.
instantly you put it in dollars or Indian rupees, are okay?
Normally you would put it in rupees actually. I don't know why have you put it in dollars?
So, some people ask in dollars as well. I mean, some people ask in dollars as well.
But I think if you are looking at very large amounts of investment, right, then I think you put it in dollars as well. But hopefully for this,
rupees
is good. Rupees is good. I mean, you can use one, like, primarily you are looking a lot in Indian investors, and I think it's better to use rupees.
Yeah.
For a lot of investors, they're comfortable with gold. Yeah. Yeah. Even gold and dollars. I had a question on what are really sort of the threats to the business itself, because leasing land itself is a huge challenge.
Yeah. So yeah, it's a, so the farmer can go back on his word, right? Okay. Though we sign a lease agreement, but the farmer can go back. So yes, so that is the challenge initially. But we believe that as we are demonstrating, you know, better results, and farmers are seeing difference between our work, we are ready for sowing. They are still, you know, their crop is not sown, etc. So slowly that acceptance is coming that these guys are doing something better. We are demonstrating better machines, you know, which can, you know, reduce their cycle time by 4 to 5 days, which they do not know. But we are demonstrating it to the village first time. So overall, you know, the value that we are adding, not just from a commercial perspective, but a lot of knowledge we are sharing, workshops we are doing. And so we believe that, I mean, at the end of the day, the economics, you know,
yeah,
with all said and done, I mean, a farmer who is having, say, 2 or 3 acres kind of land, I mean, even looking after the farm, that 2 or 3 acres is becoming a challenge. They say, I mean, having 2 or 3 acres is as good as not having any land.
Yeah.
Because anyway, I have to work as a daily, you know, laborer. So that 2 or 3 acres is actually becoming a burden to them. Right? So that is how we will aggregate the land, give them, you know, employment full time or part time as needed. So I mean, they will, so their income would definitely increase, you know, and the headache, you know, for managing 2 or 3 acres, they have to go to the city, you know, number of times. Just imagine if I am managing or our company is managing it, that burden comes down substantially. I can bring, you know, truck, you know, of seeds or fertilizers or pesticides in one go. So their comfort also, you know, goes up substantially.
So your intervention kind of stops at the point where you are working on the farm, on improving the farm productivity. But beyond that, about selling the crops, etc., is their own.
No, we sell it. So if it is a leasing model, then we are responsible for selling.
And are there other players in the space similar to?
So they're, I mean, I'm sure you would have known about Dynai Farms,
right,
but they are focused in one crop. But then there was one Green Tree Foods, you know, some time ago, right? So, but we believe, you know, demonstrating increased productivity is important. In the leasing model, there is value only if we are able to increase the pie. That is why increasing the productivity. If we don't increase the productivity, then there is, you know, leasing model is lost for something like this.
So far, you're just in one area of
in one area.
And that's your original hometown as well.
Yes, yes.
So that's giving you an advantage,
yes,
in sort of winning the confidence of farmers,
yes,
etc.
Yes.
So the moment one talks about beyond this particular area,
right,
you are going to have to rely on the reputational impact of farmers talking around, over, you,
yes,
know, that,
yes,
way.
Yes.
Okay.
So, but for the
so
next
how many
3 years,
farmers have you brought on?
We have leased lands from 5 farmers.
From 5.
We could have leased lands from more farmers, but we had limited financial resources. So we could have done 100 plus acres this year itself. And so we did not do, because some of them came a bit late. You know, so we needed more time for soil testing, land preparation, etc. So we have to, you know, let go of those, you know, opportunities this year. Next year, we have enough land, you know, to do 250 acres, enough farmers.
And how many people do you have?
4 people, full time. 4 people are full time, that is except the management team. Four laborers are full time, and there are part time people also employed. We have given almost, you know, 80 mandates of part time work so far in this
and
year.
As you, suppose you really expand this aggressively, you think you'll be able to find the right amount of labor and obviously.
Yeah, so we will have, so we will say the plan is that we will develop farm supervisor kind of people. People who can manage, say, 100 acres. So these are the typical, we have some people in our village and maybe nearby villages whom we have, you know, whom we know. And we believe these are educated people with, you know, 9 to 10 years, class 10 kind of people. they are doing farming and a little bit of something else. These are the people who can, you know, whom we can groom here as farm supervisor kind of people, and they can be placed at various locations. Then we will have, we will need, you know, the lead farmer, person who can manage say 500 acres, who might have 50 acres of his own land to begin with, but who would be able to influence, you know, another 400, 500, you know, acres in his region. So we will, you know, acquire, you know, to have those people, you know, carefully, and we will groom them and train them. So the skill lies in not just their base level of, you know, skill, but the amount of value that we will bring to the table, you know, in helping them planning, in helping them procuring various things, you know, etc. So we will develop, you know, those professionals.
Apologies for how basic my question sounds, and I'm sure you know the nuances better, but, you know, large companies are also getting into contract farming, so in particular, products that, you know, serve as that. You know, how does it fundamentally differ? I mean, apart from the objectives being different,
okay.
It, you know, don't they, I mean, I'm just saying, if somebody, one of the large companies decided to come to Madhya Pradesh and just lease large tracts of land, which they are doing in other parts of the country.
Yeah, they are doing. Large companies have tried this, right? Some of them have already failed. Say, but in contract farming, I can give you an example of Sanarico. Okay, they are doing contract farming on 20,000 or 25,000 acres. But that is just one or two crops, you know, that they are doing. They don't have any incentive to increase the productivity, because the end consumer will pay them. Whatever they produce from the land, they will pay, you know, the output price to the farmer, but the finally the actual burden will be borne by somebody else, right? Who is using the medical or, you know, the coconut oil or something. So there is no incentive for them to increase productivity. But over here there is an incentive, because the farmer is committing suicide. Farming is non-remunerative to him. His sons are not interested in farming. They want to run away from the villages. Right? So I am in a way helping him, you know, helping him by bringing better machines and by bringing the good ones, the good young ones, giving them a, you know, a better mode of, you know, their career. So that is the challenge. I mean, people would say that, you know, labor is, you know, enough in the villages, but it's not so. I mean, there are mechanical harvesters who are helping us, you know, who are helping the farmers get the harvest, else labor is just not available.
And you think that with your intervention, you'll be able to retain more labor in the villages as well?
Definitely, yeah. That's a very good question. So now our cropping pattern would be different. You know, we will start with grains. So grains are simple. You know, grains like soybean, wheat, chana, you know, cereals. They are simple. They can be sown. They require, you know, less care, and they can be harvested mechanically. But going forward, so 2 years down the line, then we will start having vegetables, other high-value crops. They require more labor. So by that time, we will have built the trust of people and gained the trust of people, and we would have trained them to be, you know, good, be employed as good, you know, laborers for vegetables kind of work. So that will, you know, generate more employment as well. So, I mean, by increasing their income and by giving them all the other benefits, we believe, you know, that once they join us, they would, you know, feel like leaving us.
I think some of the things to incorporate in the presentation is, one, this issue of the larger companies coming in, what they are doing, how you are different. Right? I think that's a very important part, because that's what everybody really asks, comes back to the question of who else is doing this, but the larger companies are obviously a big threat, right? And I think the other one is this whole issue of the daily day one, what kind of impact that will have, and so on.
Describing the state of agriculture currently, and just focus more on what you're doing to improve that.
Okay.
You know, because if you have 10 minutes, about 2 minutes, you don't realize it, but 2.5 minutes goes on describing the state of agriculture.
Okay.
And that cuts back from the amount of time you have to describe what you're doing, which you did very passionately, but if you just wanted to give yourself more time rather than Indian agriculture. See? you know, I think anecdotally most people will be familiar with it. And it would ensure that you have more time to talk about Bhushan Agro. That's the problem.
Yeah.
Some of them used to measure in time, so we spent about 2.5 minutes on Indian agriculture.
Okay. Thanks.
And one doesn't realize that when one's talking, it just goes. I guess the template that they give is an enabler and an instructor. Because sometimes one tends to fall into the trap of following according to the page and then you lose the flavor of what you're trying to do. So I think in any case, right up front, at least for a minute or so, you should just tell your story, whatever it is. You did that initially. It wasn't so much going through each page of the presentation. You can always fast forward to the slide, but things that people really need to see in a table, I think, are numbers. Everything else is just, you know.
In any case, anybody catch the interest, then people will follow up with big details about every single report. That's the issue. But at the beginning, it's just about traveling.
Presentation.